Dear friends and viewers, welcome back to KNS Biochemistry channel. Namaste. In this video session, I am going to talk about high throughput functional annotation, one of the area of proteomics. This is the second part of the previous session. So it is actually a continuation of the previous video session. So in this session we are going to see about high throughput functional annotation second part. Let us start the session now. Come along with me. Under proteomics, we are going to see about high throughput functional annotation of the genes and proteins. So what are these gene products? Gene products differentially expressed in healthy versus diseased tissues. So you have healthy tissues and the diseased condition of the tissues. So the expression of the gene product, that is the expression of the gene will give gene product, that is a protein. So that expression of the gene and the production of the various products from gene expression, it differs between the healthy tissue and the diseased tissue. So this may be considered drug targets, since the change in their expression level can be related to the cause and progression of the disease studied. A significant portion of the proteins produced by these genes will be unknown, and consequently their function must be characterized, because whatever gene is expressed, whether in a normal cell or in a diseased cell, and you have to see its function, that has to be categorized, that has to be studied. So the experimental elucidation of biochemical functions must be supported by computational tools, some bioinformatic tools, which can help predicting the possible function of a given protein from its amino acid sequence. So we have designed a high throughput system, that is a high throughput annotation tools are there. That is what we are going to see in this session. High throughput annotation systems, which automatically analyzes amino acid sequences of the protein deduced from differentially represented complementary DNA, cDNA clones. So this high throughput system attempts to assign a biological function to protein sequences by carrying out searches in sequence data banks and by locating functionally relevant motifs in the query sequences. The results delivered by the various prediction methods consist of the annotations of matching sequences. So here we are going to get all the data from the data banks, and you are going to analyze that. You are going to get annotations of matching sequences and or motif, that is structural motifs of the proteins, which are free format texts written by humans and therefore may describe the same concept with synonymous words. So you are going to get text, the explanation of those annotations. It is desirable to present the results in such a way that the annotations of those proteins describing the same biological function are totally grouped together, and it is given as a single annotation. So to this end, we devised an algorithm. So see that for that we are having high throughput algorithm, that is computational algorithm, that enables the hierarchical clustering of free format documents. These are all the hierarchical documents based on their contents. The system is capable of detecting and flagging conflicting annotations and will speed up the interpretation of the function prediction results. So whatever happened earlier in old version whatever you are doing, whatever research you are doing, it is done in a wet lab. That is, you are doing it in the laboratory manually. It is called wet lab conditions. So whatever happened to wet lab, which is that it is done with so many see that problems, so many hurdles are there. As I said by Alejandro Caro, experimentally annotating one complete bacterial genome. You are going to annotate one complete bacterial genome. It varies from organism to organism. Roughly speaking, it could take as much as $25,000 expenses, and it needs a period of 6 to 12 months, that is maximum 1 year, for completing this process. You see that when you are doing it wet lab, the time consumption is maximum 1 year. See the amount spent on that, $25,000. This is the condition of wet lab. But when you are going for genome annotation using biological computation, using computer aided softwares, you see that expenses are very less. The time consumption is not up to 6 months or 1 year. It is far less than that. So that is the advantage of doing that high throughput annotation using computational softwares. So what is this genome annotation? Genome annotation can be done in two ways. One is a structural annotation, where you are going to study about the gene structure prediction, identifying elements like introns, exons, stop codon, start codon, CDS in the genome. So that data, that entire information is taken together, and it is made as a data. It is a structural annotation. Other side, if you are going to take the product of this gene, that is, you are going to see about functional annotation, that is gene function. So under functional annotation, gene function prediction is done. That is the product of the gene product is a protein, and you are going to see the function of those gene products, that is attaching biological information to these elements, like the proteins, they are produced from exon, that will code for some information or some biological pathway, some biochemical metabolism like that. So you are going to predict those functions. It is called functional annotation. So where do annotations come from? Annotations, you see that they are inferred from experiment. That is, you are going to do it experimentally in models, cell models. It is most reliable. It is based for computational method, because we are going to use computational method using computers. Then it is inferred from computational method like sequence similarities. That is, a BLAST search is there, structural similarity, etc. All these things are studied here. Then inferred from author statement. That is, sometimes some authors might have identified something that from that you can come to a conclusion, or you can take initiation from that statement. Then curator statement and obsolete evidence quotes. So using all these data, you are coming to a conclusion that some annotation should be done for a particular protein or a particular bacterium or a particular organism. Then you can start doing annotation using computational tools. So when you take functions of the cell, what it means, what is it? If you ask a cell biologist, according to a cell biologist, function might refer to the network of interactions in which the protein participates, or the location to a certain cellular compartment. So according to cell biologist, this is the function, network interaction and the location which happens in the cellular compartment. If you ask a biochemist, what is a function? Then according to him, the function refers to the metabolic process in the biochemical metabolism, in which a protein is involved, or to the reaction catalyzed by an enzyme. So this is what is known as function. So you are going to talk about the functional annotation, metabolic process, or reaction catalyzed by enzyme, or reaction catalyzed by a protein. So that functional annotation we are going to talk about. So functional annotation, now it consists of attaching biological information to genomic elements. What kind of information, biological information, you are going to add with the genomic elements? Biochemical functions like metabolic functions, biological functions of a cell, then any other involved regulation and interactions of cellular compartments, then expression, the expression of the gene products. All are these biological informations are attached with the genomic elements. So this is what is known as functional annotation. Here you can see that the picture, the picture representation of this one. Assemble the pieces, right? So you are going to take the genome. This is the entire genome of an organism, but it is fragmented into several pieces. So assemble these pieces in a right way. Genome assembly. It is called a genome assembly. See that the genome is cut into several pieces, and they are all placed in random order. See that they are all arranged in a proper way. You'll get the genome assembly. So you'll get some message. After assembling the genome properly, the pieces of the genome, you'll get a proper message from the genome. Then gene prediction. So your genome has been arranged properly. Now you are going to identify the work of the each gene. So take this is the genome. From that you take one particular genome here, or another genome here, another genome here. You take that gene and elaborate it. What is the function of that particular gene? So the elaboration, that is called gene prediction. Then once the gene is predicted, you must know what is the function of that gene. That what is the product, the gene product of that gene. That gene product will have some function. So if you study that gene product, detailed study about the gene product, then it is called a functional annotation. So here you can see that a person who studies or is an expert in natural history, especially a zoologist or a botanist, an adherent of naturalism in literature or art, origin, see that 1580 to 1590, natural ways, that information is available in the databases. Take that one, identify the function, that is the meaning of each word here, the meaning of each word. You have several words here and you have to identify the meaning of each word from the database. So that is each word is a gene. Identify the meaning of the gene means identify the function of that each gene. And all these informations are collected as a profile here. That is called a functional annotation. It is collected as a single profile. So origin of species comes here, because you are going to take the entire genome sequence and you are going to find out, identify the function of all those genes, and you are going to collect it as a single profile. It has become a profile of a genome, the genome profile of a particular organism. Then that will speak about origin of that species. On the origin of species by means of natural selection or the preservation of favored races in the struggle for life. So you see that origin of the species can be easily predicted using this profile, because it is an entire genome profile of an organism. So that is called functional annotation. Systems used for functional annotation. What kind of systems can be used for doing functional annotation? You can take clusters of orthologous groups, orthologous genes. The genes which are present in closely related species in a hierarchical tree, and they have the same function in all the species. So cluster from that orthologous groups, you can take functional annotation. Eukaryote ortholog groups, gene ontology, enzyme commission number. So from all these data, you can do functional annotation. Clusters of orthologous group of genes, that is KOGs and COGs. Why we have to take all these clusters? Orthologs are the genes, okay? They are present in related species. So orthologs retain the same function during evolution, and hence they have a critical role in functional annotation. So these ortholog clusters provides a framework for functional analysis, that functional annotation. It's also important for phylogenetic and evolutionary analysis of genomes, because it has taken from closely related species, so it gives a lot of information about phylogenetic analysis or evolutionary analysis. Interpretable phylogenetic trees generally can be constructed only within sets of orthologs. So if you have this functional annotation of these ortholog groups, then you can go for comparative genomic study. Comparative genomics. So if you want to see more details about comparative genomics, you can refer my YouTube channel. I have posted one separate is the video for comparative genomics. How to find orthologous genes? And you see that there is an approach, naive approach. For a query gene and a target gene, target genome, the highest similarity score indicates homologous relationship. So highest similarity score can be done by BLAST or FASTA. So from that you can indicate homologous relationship between the closely related species. It gives good results for not so distant species. How about larger phylogenetically distant species? So here gene duplications, which suggests that a many to many relationship required. What if several hits with not a so high score emerge? So stringent threshold may lead to false negatives. Sometimes it is that closely related species will have duplication of the gene, then from that many to many relationship can be studied. If it is not seen in close related, far away related species, sometimes you may have it. From that you can get some false negative results, but still these species may have long back, if you go, they may have evolutionary relationship. In the hierarchical tree, it will help you in comparative genomics. So this orthologous, that is naive approach, will give you both the data. Another one is COG, COG approach. Each two genes inside a COG, that is orthologous genes, are either orthologous genes or orthologous groups of paralogs. So through that approach also, you can do this annotations. Here schematic flow diagram of the function prediction pipeline for a particular annotation, functional annotation. Here complementary DNA sequences are taken, cDNA sequences of a species, possibly more than one per clone. It enters the pipeline at the top. Here you can see that cDNA sequence enters the sequence, that is the flow here on the top. Okay. So and will be used as queries in a number of nucleic acid database searches with BLAST. So cDNA sequence is taken and it is searched using nucleic acid databases like BLAST is used here, and you see that from that you will get the value, that is the p-value. So sequences with number of significant matches or with matches to genes of unknown function will be translated into protein sequences and enter the protein prediction stage. And you see that from that you are going to say, suppose if the more p-value is there, you'll be going here DNA, or from there expression of the DNA product is protein, translation happens and protein sequence is analyzed, and from that you are going to get the motifs searches, structure is the motif of the protein and structure prediction of the domain prediction of the protein, and both are coming here as output. Or you can go for sequences analysis searches, that is amino acid sequence searches, or structure prediction structure, domain prediction structure, then you will get the output. Or if the p-value is less, you can go the other way, novel prediction is done, function is unknown here, so you can go for further analysis, DNA to protein analysis, then you will get the output, then from that you can find out these sequences. So here you see the results of the various similarity searches and the simple structure predictions are then merged into finally as an output here, and this data is attached with the genome. Then you will get functional annotation of that genome or that particular species. You can see that functional annotation done stepwise. First, you are going to take the entire genome of a species, transcribe that. Primary transcript you will get. RNA. Then RNA processing is done. You will get processed RNA, that is called mRNA, messenger RNA, with ATG and stop codon. Then take this mRNA, translate it. You will get polypeptide. This polypeptide can be further folded. So the protein folding happens and you will get folded protein. And for this protein, amino acid sequence study, structural study, domain study, motif study, all these studies are done. That is called studying functional activity of that protein. So you are going to find the functions of this particular protein, folded protein. Or if that protein is an enzyme, what is the enzymatic activity of this particular enzyme? A to B, it is a reaction where this enzyme is doing some enzyme activity. And you study that one also. Everything is comes under functional activity. So you are going to get the output as I mentioned in the previous flowchart. Finally, that output will be the entire information about the functional annotation of this particular genome. And that will be attached with this genome. So once you click that genome in the database, you'll get the entire functional annotation of that genome. Here you can see that graphical representation. Graphic representation of the workflow followed for high throughput RNA sequence data analysis. Suppose you have taken a mosquito, for example. You want to study the genome structure of a particular mosquito. For example, malarial mosquito. The mosquito which causes malaria or your dengue fever. Take any one mosquito. And from that you take the genome. Nano injections and co-infection, all this done. Then from that you are going to take a collection of mosquitoes and sample mosquitoes, and from that mosquitoes you extract the RNA, total RNA extraction. Then RNA sequence reads Illumina, and you are going to fragment the RNA into several fragments. Sequence can be read, reading the RNA sequences for using some methods, computational methods. Alignment of headquarter reads to genome, and from that sequences the entire genome, entire genes, transcripts of the gene is they are aligned, organized properly, and these genes or transcripts are aligned. Alignment of the genome is done. Now the gene is ready, aligned gene is ready. Then you can go for annotation, previous picture and previous flow. It's a workflow. We have seen that genome is there. Take the genome, same procedure. Annotation of the genes, vector based or kick based method is done. Identification of significant genes, then taking the details of that gene products, and they are studied here, and the output comes, and you'll get the output of those proteins, and they are the output results of these proteins. Then the structural domain, motif domain, structures of those proteins. And this is what is known as functional annotation of the entire genes or entire genome of this particular mosquito. And you can take this functional annotation of these genes and attach with this mosquito genome. When you click this mosquito genome, you'll get entire details about the gene, including structural annotation, functional annotation, genome annotation, everything. This is one example, functional annotation of a particular species, attaching biological information to genomic elements like biochemical function, biological function, in regulation, other functions, they are all attached here. You see that this is the entire functional annotation details of the species, for example, for that particular mosquito genome. So everything is there, biochemical gene functions details, biological function details, regulatory function details, everything is there. They are all attached. That is shown here also. Genomic, functional, structural annotations. This is the output. So if you have the functional annotations of each species, you can go for phylogenetic study, phylogeny, or hierarchical tree can be drawn. Here you can see that Niels Narcos Lauritsen, they have drawn a phylogenetic tree for a particular species. Multilocus sequence phylogenetic study of the genus. Which genus? Phylogenetic tree of a genus, Haemophilus genus. Description of Haemophilus pitamenae species is shown here. Now see that the phylogenetic tree starts from at the beginning E. coli. If you go back in a long way, that E. coli will be there. 1 minute, I'll come. அது முடிஞ்சது இப்ப நான் கிளாஸ் எடுத்துக்கேன். ஆ சரி ஆ சரி ஓகே. அந்த பேப்பர் இங்க இருக்கு, நான் போட்டோ எடுத்து எடுக்கணுமா? ஆ சரி ஓகே. So this is the phylogenetic tree structure of the genus Haemophilus. In that one species, Haemophilus pitmanii. Here you see that from E. coli, through evolution it has come. Phylogenetic tree gives all the entire details. It comes from E. coli. This is the relationship between several subspecies. All are coming from one genus, Haemophilus. In that you give that you can have a relationship. You see that there is a relationship between this species and this species, close relationship. These two are related with the other two, and these four are related with these two, and these two are related with the other two. So there is a link. You see that direct or indirect relationship is there. So if we take the entire relationship between all these species, so that you can draw a tree like this. This is called phylogenetic. So from that, if you look into this phylogenetic, you can understand the evolutionary, you see that changes which has happened in this genus and species. Which genus and in that how many species are closely related, that is far away related, and how that evolution has happened through time. All these datas are easily, you can get it from this phylogenetic tree. So this is the one way you can understand the evolution or the relationship between the species. So that is why for phylogenetic analysis, functional annotation, genomic annotations are going to give you a lot of information. They are going to help you a lot. Then you can draw a tree. Similarly, for human population also, already I mentioned human population also, you can draw phylogeny tree. For example, your own population, your own community. For that, you can draw a phylogenetic tree. See that all these things can be done computational biology, that is using computers. What you need is softwares and datas and samples. So from that you can draw a phylogenetic tree for your own community. So from that you can come to a conclusion that what is the origin of your species, what is the origin of your population, what is the origin of your community population, your individual community population. That can be scientifically proved using this phylogenetic tree. So that is why phylogenetic study and annotations of the species have become more very 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 important in this scenario. So that is very easy to do it, because we need the helps of the computer aided softwares are there. So functional annotations and the genomic annotations, structural annotations of any species will help you a lot to draw a phylogenetic tree for a particular species or particular genus or a particular group, that is a population group. In human population, you can go for population studies, group population, community population, like that, regional population, like that, you can study that. Friends, in this session I have explained you in detail about high throughput functional annotation of proteins. I hope you have understood the topic well. With this I am going to stop this session. I'll be coming back with another session. Until then, it's bye from KNS Biochemistry. Thank you. Thank you and all. Thank you very much. Namaskar.